somebody may wondering, you know, how this whole thing really works. Yeah, if I have to work my development, how do I get started? What is my starting point and what is my ending point? How do I come to know what should I do on the day one? Should I do a requirement prioritization, or how do I create my ways of working? So there are 5-step process which I'm introducing so that you get a sufficient understanding about the discipline agile content outline. So what they tell is that the whole objective is choose your ways of working. Yeah, that's the whole thing. Ultimately, I personally believe whichever framework you use, you are the owner of your ways of working, and you need to own it. And the sooner you do, the better it is. Don't blame XXX framework or a methodology or a toolkit if something is not working, because those were very standard things. They were made for a given context and they may not work as it is in your context. The sooner you own it, the things will start working. So what is the approach which DA is talking about? It is telling, first, before you even pick up a process, yeah, don't say we will do Scrum. Don't say we will do Kanban, or don't say we will do Waterfall. Well, you need to decide based on your context. Look at, do I have a dynamic requirement, or I have a stable requirement, or whatever, that there could be some parameters which you can use to understand what problem I am solving, in which area I am operating in. So there has to be an evaluation of your context. Now, how to do it? There are some tools which can help you in doing it, and I will introduce one of them in the rest of the content. Now, once you understand your context, then you select the best fit life cycle. So the idea here is there could be one life cycle which may look like a Scrum. There could be another life cycle which may look like a Kanban. There could be another life cycle which might be needing project way of working, where you have project charter, initial level of funding, milestones, and governance process in place. It's very difficult to say for an organization that this organization will always do a continuous delivery, or this organization will always do a project. There could be the areas where project way of working might be needed. There might be areas where the continuous delivery way of working might be needed. So once you analyze your context, and it might be very difficult to assume that organization operate in just one context. There are organizations, there are support teams which are taking care of existing products. There are teams which are creating new innovative product. They don't even know will this product will succeed or not. And there are teams which are creating a next version of an existing successful product. Now, we cannot replicate one team's process to another team because they are working in a different context. So analyze the context, and based on that, select the best fit life cycle. So Discipline Agile gives you 6 choices. We'll talk about them. So it's like you are selecting your bigger frame. So you need to stitch your ways of working, but the stitching of ways of working may require the outer layer to get ready first. And by selecting the life cycle, you are creating that outer framework, frame for your work. And then you get deeper and connect the dot, the third process which they are talking about. So there could be various process goals. Yeah, in some places, you may need to hire the developers and create a new team. In some contexts, you don't need that. So you don't have a process goal of bringing, forming the team. Team is already formed. So depending upon where you fit, even your context is well understood, we try to understand that, okay, in this delivery space, we have X number of goals. Which are the goals are more relevant for us based on our context and selection of life cycle? We identify the process goals. So process goal can be understood like forming a team, creating a shared vision for the product. It's a process goal. Coordinating activities with each other is a process goal. So this out of these, we have a list of those process goals. So the team come together and they need to find out which are the process goals are relevant for us. That's a step 3. Now, when we go into deeper, we understood the process goals, assuming coordinating activities with each other is a process goal. Now, how to do it? We need to make some choices. Now, you can do a daily 15 minutes meeting, or you can do with the help of a digital dashboard also. If you have a situation where your team members are spread across multiple geographies and multiple time zones, you may prefer not to have a 15 minutes meeting. You don't want everybody to come together. You want them to look at a digital space, and that is how they probably will operate. Now, the another team which is working in the more or less in the same time zone may use a 15 minutes meeting to coordinate their work. And that is how we are making the choices. So it is not a one choice which is applied to all the teams, even if their life cycle is same, but depending upon their context, they can have different way of achieving how do we coordinate activities with each other. And that's the fourth step. And when we have the fourth step, you have your ways of working ready. So you have a life cycle, you understand which of the process goals are important, and you know how are you going to achieve those process goals. And then continuously improvement. So the whole idea is, be it a discipline or a XYZ framework, even in the waterfall world, there was always a need of continuous improvement. And we may just pick up the waterfall methodology as defined in our organization templates, not in a book. Yeah. And we just follow it and never look for inspecting and adapting and continuously improving it. And then we blame the waterfall. Then it might be not the right idea to do. So any framework, it is a good starting point. And here the difference they are telling is, we are doing guided continuous improvement. So it's like this: when you are looking for improvement, again, you may relook at all the processes which are available to you, because the knowledge base is giving you collection of processes. You don't have to reinvent your own process all the time. Sometimes you may want to reinvent that, but majority of the cases, you may find something which you can use from the Discipline Agile toolkit space itself. So these are the 5-step processes. I go a little bit detail into of all the 5 steps, and probably that will help you in getting some insight about Discipline Agile. I know there is a limitation of time, and I'm trying to give a practical thing rather than talking about theories and principles and values of Discipline Agile, something which you can feel and definitely you can learn further if you like the idea. So analyze the context. So they have a kind of a factors or a context identification framework. They call it scaling factor identification thing. And in a way, you can say that I sit with my team and I need to understand, where do I stand? So maybe I am a team one. I may say I have a 10 people working together. We are co-located. We are the single organization. All of us belong together. And we are always, we have a skills which are needed to get the job done. Compliance is, we are not working in a very complicated compliance environment. That's a one thing. And our application is integration. It's a new, but it will integrate with something else. Our domain is somewhere between complex and straightforward. So this is how they are identifying their context. This is a particular team. So you can see, based on the context definition, their process challenges or the selection might also vary. There could be another team, assuming this particular team are 50 people. They are working globally, different time zone, and they have the multiple organization. So it's like that they have a outsourced part of work. So they are paying some of their partners. Some of the work is done by vendors or service provider. The skills are easy to acquire. They are not working on very complicated skills. Compliances, there are some regulatory space they are working in, assuming they are working in a banking or some other space. So they have a regulatory oversight need to be seen. And the application integrates with multiple new as well as legacy applications. And domain is decently complex. Now, if I say the blue color, this is a team B, and then there could be a red color is a team A. Now, can I put one framework for both of these teams? Even to start with, forget about later on. Later on, definitely they will learn this is not working for us. Yeah, definitely they will know. But do I give them a one framework to start? Now, Discipline Agile saying that might be too much. You know, you are definitely setting them for a failure before you fix them. So why don't you analyze the context and see, you know, A is very different than B. A may do a 15 minutes daily stand-up meeting, but B may not do a daily stand-up meeting. There are 50 people and they are spread across multiple geographies and there are paid partners. We need to take care of the details of what they are doing. There are compliances. We need to have a strict documentation to ensure that, else we are in a soup. Now, somebody will say B should not follow Agile. Why? You know, B also requires some amount of agility. But the definition of agility of a B and A will be very different. Yeah, but both of them are agile in their own context. So that's the whole idea. So people coming together, and some of you are asking, what if we do the wrong choices and all? So people come together and they need to explore in the beginning of their initiative. And the another thing is, this context may change over time. So you start with like A, and maybe after a few months, you may end up into B, because you were initially experimenting a new product or service. And when this new product or service started making sense, it started expanding bigger and bigger and bigger. And now you have moved towards B space. So you might be started with the process A, but over a period of time, you need to continuously keep analyzing your context. And that's the continuous improvement you are making. And that's the whole idea of the step 5. So first you do analyze of your context, and that's your starting point. And there are tools and frameworks. There are further guidance how to find out where do you stand. That's the beauty of the framework or a toolkit. I must use the word toolkit. And once you do that, step one is over. Then you talk about select best fit lifecycle. So what does it mean? So the DA is saying, we don't have any love for one way of working. We love variations. We love choices. So we are okay with the confusion, one team doing Kanban, one team doing Scrum, one team doing project, one team doing Lean Startup, and one team doing is a large program level work, which is looks like a safe. So there could be a different teams doing differently. So team A, maybe initially start with something called Agile Lifecycle. So maybe a project which is built on Scrum. So the Agile Lifecycle is primarily saying, add project management thing, initiation and closing thing in a way, they call it inception and transition phase to Scrum. So it gives a structure to the initiating and closing activity because that might be the context needing. So when you are using an Agile Lifecycle, you may start it with the team A, you produce something at the end. Later on, when you want it to grow and you want to have a 20 teams or 20, say 50 people working for you, you may go for a program lifecycle. So you may change the lifecycle as you go along. So I briefly give an introduction of these six lifecycles so that you know how possibly we can make a choice. So Agile lifecycle, as I said, Scrum plus project management. Lean lifecycle, you can say Kanban plus project management. So these are primarily saying Scrum-based, Kanban-based, plus some having some initiating and closing activities, which bring some structure, some initial estimation, some initial vision, some initial architecture, because that might be needed in a project term. That might be needed when you are governed well, yeah, because you have a regulatory reasons to follow. So that's a choice one and two. If you don't have project way of working and you just want to work on a continuous delivery model, you work on a sprint, you finish the sprint, you release during the sprint or at the end of a sprint, the next sprint is the next release, then they call it continuous delivery lifecycle. So continuous delivery lifecycle is more or less exact the way Scrum is defined. It is like, okay, let's start with the product backlog, prioritize it. Each iteration, we find out what is the best value we can give. We deliver the value in the iteration and we move to the next iteration. It's a continuous delivery. Now, in the continuous delivery, same format using Kanban. So you might say, okay, we are doing continuous delivery. We don't do a sprint planning and time boxing and all those stuff. That's overhead for us because we have changed our context. We want to do a continuous delivery lean lifecycle. So these four options, technically speaking, they are Scrum and Kanban options only. One, Scrum with and Kanban with a project-related approach. Another is a Scrum and Kanban with non-project-related approach. And then we have another two interesting one, the Lean Startup Lifecycle, which is very exploratory in nature, where there might be no estimation. There may be primarily a time boxing and creating some experiment, showing those experiments to the people and taking the feedback and figuring out, is this the right thing to do? Primarily strengthening the business case for a future work. So that could be a very exploratory work, which you may want to do in a lean lifestyle cycle approach. And the program lifecycle is primarily might be using, the teams might be using any of these four, and then you want to integrate these teams together so that they can work on a larger program. So it is providing the leadership layer on top of it, and then we're taking it forward. So first you analyzed your context, and the second thing you do, and you do regularly, is select your life cycle. And that's how you can say it's a very different than and any of the existing approaches for working with a child. I'm not saying it's good or bad, it's different. Yeah, that's the whole thing. Now, the third thing you do, so first, I repeat again, you analyze your context. Second, you have selected the life cycle. Now, depending upon what work you are doing, this particular is a discipline agile delivery part. If you are doing development, then these process goals are relevant and they are primarily project process goals, all the possible process goals of a delivery part of it, development part of it. There are other process blades will have other goals. You need to identify which goals are relevant for you. You may not want to work on all the areas. So for example, you may say, oh, forming the team, I already have a team. I don't need this particular thing. This is not priority for me. Yes, I need to understand the scope. I need to plan the release because these people are too much interested in the release. There could be another project where they may say, or another initiative where they say, release is not an important. We are continuously delivering it. Let's start with the direct construction phase related goals. So the third thing people do with the help of a stakeholder, they try to identify which all areas, which all process goals, like forming the team, securing the funding, creating a common vision, or deploying the solution or improving quality, many of them will be always needed, but there could be some which might be not needed depending upon our context. So we try to find out which are the process goals are relevant for us. So we are getting into the details. So first we just look at the situation, define the problem, then we looked into the bigger frame, which was a life cycle. Now we are getting into the details of inside the life cycle, which all process goals are relevant for us. Now, once we do this step three, then we get into the detail of a particular goal. So this is an example. So assuming you selected developing a common vision as a goal, now it is like a decision tree. So first, once you reach to the particular process blade, you have a various processes. Each process goal has a multiple ways of achieving it. So each process goal, you need to, for example, develop a common vision. You need to consider various things related to developing a common vision. So you can say these are various decision points and there are various ways of achieving it. So say you need to decide how detailed my vision should be. So you can decide it could be lightweight, it could be detailed. And there are advantages and disadvantages associated with it. You may need to decide, do we need to have a level of agreement? Is it a general agreement? We must have a consensus or someone can dictate it. So in order to achieve this process goal, these are the considerations or areas I need to work on. And each area is associated with various options. And in the real book where you have these details, each options plus and minuses, the pros and cons are elaborated. So it is clearly elaborated. Why should you choose a lightweight? Why should you use detailed? In which situation you should use what? So that's the value of the toolkit or a knowledge. And in some cases, you also see a preferences. So you can see there is an arrow mark. Yeah, this arrow mark is showing. So arrow mark is an indicator. In general, these things are sorted from the order of preference. So your vision strategy should be collaborative. That's the order of preference. But there could be a situation where it could be a team-driven, sponsor-driven, and we can discuss and explore those situations as we go along. The bold, you may see some of them are bold also. So bold are showing, typically, if you don't have very much complication, this is the approach to go forward. So if you have a simple scenario, if you have a simple team, and you don't have many deviations related to agile way of working, these bold are the ones which are generally chosen. So in a way, the toolkit is giving you option, the toolkit is giving you the preference information, and the toolkit is also sharing some of the things which are usually picked up. Yeah. So you, after reaching to a step four, you find out what is going to work for me. So I spoke about the example of coordinating activity as a goal. One team may decide to do every day 15 minutes call. Another team may decide not to have it, but have a chat room or a digital dashboard to manage and coordinate their work. So that's something you find out and do it. So that's a make some choices. And then finally, you move guided continuous improvement. So this is something you focus on. Whatever you have done in step 1, 2, 3, 4, everything is challengeable. There is nothing frozen. Discipline is not about following the line all the time. Discipline is all about challenging the line and finding the best possible line. So it is like we have a 4 steps and it is not, we are not going haywire, but all the time we are asking, is this the right thing we are doing? So we may analyze our context periodically with the help of retrospective. We may choose our goals again. We may change our life cycle. We may move from project life cycle to a continuous delivery life cycle or a vice versa. We choose our process goals again. We make some choices, change of the choices, assuming because of the various learning which we have made. And that's how we continuously improve. The word, the guided they use here is you are not starting from blank. Yeah, even when you are analyzing this, our toolkit is coming as an asset. Rather than you just think, okay, what should we do next? It is just not based on the judgment, but the industry knowledge is given to you in order to support your decision making.